try to work around that or work with it, but at least teams are not always as maintainable as you'd like to see. So I came up with the idea of how I always approach building a group of teams. And the core of that is autonomy design. Now, what is autonomy design? For those of you who haven't heard about autonomy design, in 2013, Brett Frost published a blog post where he explains what autonomy design is. And well, before that time, pages were often designed and implemented on a per page basis. So you were designing and developing pages as a whole instead of components. But his concept of autonomy designs actually involves five different parts. But the first part are atoms, then there's molecules, organisms, templates, and pages. And by dividing designs and pages into these five parts, you can make more maintainable design choices. So let's start with atoms. The atoms, they are the basic building blocks of all matter, both in science but also in theming, front-end implementation. In the front-end approach, you can link atoms to, for example, buttons or input elements or simple labels. So like the smallest elements of any web page you can find. They are not useful on their own, so atoms really have to be part of something bigger to be of any meaning. But they are the smallest building blocks that there are. First, I think there's atoms won't help. So we can combine multiple atoms, maybe smaller parts, into molecules. And molecules are combinations of atoms and maybe some other helping elements, leaves, wrappers, built for use. So most of the small parts you build on the website are going to be molecules. Then there's organisms. And as you might have guessed, organisms can combine group of molecules here. Now this might seem a bit useless, but I'll better hope you see why this makes sense. You can also choose to see organisms as a way of not only combining molecules, but also forming molecules that would have grown way too big and way too complex in your organisms. Then there's templates. And what's important to note about templates is that this is not a mapping of the Drupal templates, but this is a template, as Greg Frost describes it, basically a whole page without any content. So you have, it's basically like a wireframe. And the wireframe gives an idea, a general idea of how the page is going to be, what components will be there, and what the position more or less will be, but they don't have any content. And last but not least, there's pages, which are actually the templates we saw on the previous slide with some actual content in it. Now, what does this all bring us? This is only design. We have a separate and clearly defined set of components, and these components, they're easy to combine. So you can just grab a button, you look where you have defined ones, you follow out how the buttons should look, how you should behave, and you have molecules and organisms that you can basically mix and match to create either a new secondary site or make a new page. Because of that, you have fewer components overall, because you just stick to one button you already have, maybe there's one or two exceptions, there's not an orange button, there's another blue one. But you have fewer components because you can reuse what you already have. There's more consistent code and more consistent design, because for the same reasons you already have a set defined somewhere. And there's more modular faster. Now the theory, of course, is very nice for this. However, there's also some coding that has to be done. And being partially front-ender, I'll dive into a front-end thing called Ben. What is Ben? Ben is nothing new, it's nothing too fancy, but actually just a naming convention for CSS classes. And Ben is a abbreviation which stands for block, element, and modifier. Now, if we dive, if also very important Drupal log, and actually you'll find that some of the Drupal modules and some of the core will use them itself. And the main reason to do so is that it prevents very high CSS specificity. What do you mean by this? You might have encountered this before. You work on a theme, and then there's some CSS because you need to remove borders. So you find an element, and then you apply it so you need, and then you go. And then later on, you find there's another component that also needs to be overridden. That's a child of this item. So you think, okay, sure, we just can concatenate the other class behind it. It's a better sign we like. Then it happens again. Again. And again. Now, of course, you can imagine that if you do this, you might think, okay, this is a pretty easy way to find a solution for the need. But once you need to overwrite, for example, the starting of one of the last items that you go down, you have to include this whole specificity chain every time you want to make an override, which is not very flexible, and especially not very maintainable. I will tell you one small secret. This is actual CSS running somewhere on the collection. I won't tell you where, but one of the reasons this code. Now, what about the band naming convention? Let's start with the blog. Actually, one thing to note down before I go on is that the blog in band is definitely not the same as a Drupal blog. So forget everything you know for a second about Drupal blogs. And think of blogs as just the general name of a component. It describes the component and that's it. So if you have a component, for example, a profile header, then the then accepted blog name would be profile header. So far so good. Then there's elements. And what are elements? Elements are all the various items that you can find within a blog. So they're also always part of a blog, which means that you can never use an element on its own. It always has to be nested inside an element, inside the blog that we found before. There's various notations of them. I personally prefer the notation of using two underscores between blog name and element name. They can also be nested, but you can never have two elements on the same blog. Because code does more than what I can do, I have a small example of that. But for example, you see the same profile header blog created before, but right now there are 3-4 elements inside. And as you can see, they all have their own class names, only just one class name for now. And you can see that the class names always are the blog name, followed by two underscores, and then the name of the element. Then the last letter of them, the M, stands for modifier. And you can use modifiers if you actually want to describe appearances, or actually appearances that are not a regular appearance of the blog, but if you have some modifications. For example, something being large or small or red or blue, then you can use the modifier to do so. Again, just like the element, never use the modifier class on its own. It also always has to go together with either the block or the element class. Like I just said, it can also be part of both the block and the element class, so you can choose which of these you want to apply the modifier on. You can also have multiple modifiers, for example, say I want to have a block which is blue and large, so you can combine that. Personally, I always like the double dash notation between the block and the modifier, or the element and the modifier. And it gives us this. For example, with the same profile header block, for example, if we want to have an inactive version, you can say, okay, with profile header, and also the profile header inactive class. And you can do the same for elements. You can have the info element, and then also the profile header info large. necessarily won't be affected because it is in a growth factor. So, for example, like I mentioned margins, if I would need to put a margin bottom of, I don't know, 1,000 pixels on the avatar, then I control the avatar class. But then everywhere I use the avatar and the avatar class, I get the margin bottom. I can override it, of course, but that would be very not very useful. So instead, I can put the margin on the profile avatar, which is the same as an element. The same margin will be applied, but then it's very useful because the avatar itself is not affected. What's the result of all this? Well, the result is that, as you can see, the CSS classes that are generated are really flat. We have no specificity. Everything is just one level deep, and that's a really good advantage to what we saw in one of the first slides. So no more specificity, and also not very important is that we also don't have cell binding. Cell binding is what happens when you, for example, want to sell a link, so you have a bit of CSS that says everything should be blue, and then you have a different element, and you say, okay, the link in this class should be red, and suddenly you find out that all your links are red. Won't happen with this. And last but not least, your results are really predictable when you use the CSS. Because you know if you change something in the profile of the class, everything that will change is anything that has the profile of the class. So other classes won't be affected. You don't have to, but you can also use this with subs or less or in other CSS preprocessor images. And what's really cool is that in SAS you could use the ampersand setter, strange pretty thing. And by using the ampersand setter in SAS, you can actually prepend the parent class. So you don't have to type profile header every time you get it again. Because of this, it's also very flexible, because if you want to change the name of the profile component, you can just do so in one place, and all the other parts will follow. Another advantage of this is that it's very easy to split components into different files. You can, for example, have one SAS file with all the styles for the profile letter, and then any other component can have all of its styles in a different file. So, one of the advantages of having components and component-based design and even component-based classes is that you can create style guidelines. And the style guidelines is basically just an overview of all the components that are in the design and the website. Designers or researchers often use style guides to get a visual library of buttons and things to use. But for developers, front-end developers, but also back-end developers, can be really handy to quickly scroll through a document and find there's already a button or something that they have to implement. Of course, it might be cumbersome to build, so to build one from the startup, but there's a thing called CSS, which is written especially with this in purpose. So what is it? CSS stands for canonical style sheets. It's a bit of a weird name, but apparently you got it. Follow this. And basically it's a definition for how you can document your CSS or SAS files with the purpose of generating style sheets from it. Sorry, style guides. You can of course define your components, which would also be handy as if you can document different variations on a component. For example, you can document the hover style of the component, or you can document the modifiers you have to the component. Of course, because it's meant to use by style guides, it's pretty parsable, and also there's no requirements on the file naming or the file structure of your theme or of your CSS files. So how does this look? Well, this is an example of a CSS comment. In, like you can see, just an actual SAS file. reference a trig file that contains the marker, because Drupal also uses trig, so it's pretty convenient. You can also choose to just inline your HTML directly if you want. Not from the table, but. And then you can last also include the style byte section, so you can have different sections in your style byte or you split some of the components. KSS is just a documentation specification, but there are specific implementations that you can use in your build set. I always use Node.js implementation because most teams use Node.js anyway. The output of this is some HTML and CSS that just contains all the elements that you have to find in your style guide. The cool thing is that the Node.js implementation works with quite a lot of template languages. Of course, you can use regular HTML, also Twig, Handlebars, Node.js. It works with CSS, Sass, Stylus for the parsing of comments. Actually, I think we can work with almost any file because you can specify which file extension should be parsed for the actual comments. It has separate JSON files for the data. Of course, when you have Drupal in place, the Drupal installation will provide you with the data to show you the component. If your server is not linked to Drupal in like a marker, so you can view the server without having Drupal in place. You can use JSON files to supply data to show in the server. And you can you don't have to specify every file you want to parse. You can just say search in this directory for all the cases that you can find. And if you want to, you can include additional CSS or JavaScript within your server. The result of this will look like this. It's a pretty simple overview of all different sections you have on the left side, and on the right side you can see the example, which is just HTML. You can use your inspector in browser to inspect it and view. And by doing this, you can you can view the element, you can view all the variations. For example, I have an inactive modified version here, and you can extend, you can fold out the marker. So how does this work within a Drupal team, combining all of this? Now I'll do something really scary, because I'll give you an email. I have posted the code of this on GitHub. If you want, you can take a picture of this, you can ask me later on. I'll be here, I think, until the last talk. So I'll try, so I can just show you the demo. Here. Yes, we'll see this, it's nice. And then there's even something called presentation mode, so I'll see if that helps. That's what I was looking for. So I have a, I have a pretty simple Drupal theme setup. I have appropriately called it Drupal Jam. And what I have done here, I have a source folder, and the source folder contains basically all the components that I have found in the atomic file structure convention. And then I have a main folder with some global thing. For example, I don't need any more folders, but usually I like to split up this into different folders. For example, a folder for any SAS files I need, a folder for images I need, folder for JavaScript things I need that don't belong to certain components, and so on. And then the interesting, cool thing is that within the atoms folder, you can have very clear a very clear folder structure, which is one folder per component. And for example, I have something called a button, and the button folder, there's three files. JSON file with data, there's a SAS file with the styling, and there's a Twig file with the Twig template. Of course, Twig template is pretty easy because the button is very difficult. JSON file similarly is also very easy because it's just a label with some text. And then the styling is whatever styling you want for the button. And of course, you can then do is when stockout, I can show you if you want. I have just some very basic NPM scripts, so there are some repository that just uses the KSS-node implementation to generate the style guide, and the output is just put inside the style guide folder. And like you see, like I promised, it exists here HTML that you can open in your browser. You can, of course, extend this with browser change, you can extend this with live reloading, you can extend this with whatever you can think of. I have picked the most easy and plain version for the demonstration purpose. So if I go back to the button, we see that it has generated all the various variants that I have defined. Just the default button, the hover button, outline version, outline whenever it's hover. I have some other atoms, for example, cards, different things. I've got avatar, some actions. And in the molecule section, I have combined a few of those to form some molecules. So for example, this is the action component. But then bound together with a few different ones to form a actions molecule. And you can see the mark that is just will follow the convention that I just told you about. So it's class, actions, and there's the actions action, so it's the action element of the actions block. This is an action block in itself again, and so on and so on. Same for the profile header. And of course, the organism can combine all this to form an organism. And the cool thing is that you can link this to Drupal pretty easily. The one thing you will need, and that's what I have also wrote down in the README file, is that you'll need the component libraries module. What the component libraries module does, the link goes to the module page on Drupal core, and it basically, let me start over. By default, Drupal only knows to look for template files in the template script within the theme. And it will add three namespaces, like it shows here, for example, the theme Classy can be referenced by using the add Classy namespacing trick. So in this case, you can extend a specific block or trick template block within the Classy theme. But it doesn't work for different folders in your own theme. So the component libraries module will allow you to do that. You will need to do one thing for this, and it is that in your theme.info file, you have to define a section with all the namespaces that you want to be available. I have chosen to just use the atoms one plus normalism sections and just link to the folder within the source section as you can see. And you also will need to tell the style guide these same sections, which I do in here, to be sure that the style guide also knows about this. Otherwise, only Drupal knows about it, your style guide won't, and the other way around. But if you do that, then, for example, you can see that for the organism, you can include different trick files from, for example, the molecules. And this is important because this means if you don't have to redefine the HTML structure, you don't have to think about sizing, because all that is handled within the profile header component. And you only include that component in a different way. The only workaround, of course, that I have to do is that I have to include an element class, which is like the block element modifier, in this case element part of the class, of the parent block it is in. So this is the template for tweet. So the profile has the tweet profile element class. Same goes for the actions in the bottom. And then you can biology, and anything that is part of the actions, starting itself and going to the actions. So any unmeaning action, if it's subsiding, if you need to override it, you can do so. In this case, in the tree. I see that I don't have the templates folder you will usually find in the Drupal theme. But what basically happens is that I never use the templates folder to define a new HTML structure in. All I do in the templates folder is create a file with the name that Drupal expects. That will be Drupal trick name. And then all I do is include one of the other files, which is in the structure. And this is the way that I always set up my Drupal themes. I hope you learned something new, and I hope that you can start to build your own Drupal themes yourself. Thank you. There is no, I think, very, very clear definition of this is always an element, this is always a molecule, this is always an organism. It's a bit common sense, a bit whatever you're used to. What I always try to do is see if there are, I try to see what the amount of other components is, and what kind of other components you include. For example, if you only include atoms, then chances are that it might be molecule. If you find yourself including atoms and other molecules, I mean, it's not like a hard rule that you cannot include something on the same level. However, if you do so, you have to think, okay, maybe I'm actually building an organism instead of a molecule. So I think having more experience in doing these movies more often will help you judge which layer is best placed. For example, paragraphs, yeah, I could see them being both a molecule or an organism. Depends a bit on how complicated the contents are for paragraphs. Could be both. And the cool thing about using plants, I suppose. The cool thing about using structure that I always do is that the structure that Drupal appears, so the template structure Drupal has, does not define the structure using your components. Because your source directory can, and you can maintain use whatever structure you like, and then you only have to link to the Drupal template to one of the other sections. There's no hard relationship that the paragraph always has to be on, or always has to be on, so you can do and change as you like.
So if that's difficult for you, then it's even more difficult to get like consensus within the theme, right?
Yeah, you can have discussions about this for a long time. But like I said, the more you do this, especially within the theme, the more you start to get the consensus on what's the best way to go.
And one more being practical, that this KSS, is that specific to them syntax or
no? No, you can. It's just a documentation. Actually, it's just a specification of the CSS. tailwind or something like that, then you would pretty soon get a lot of variations that might not all clearly describe the components that are available. So you don't have to use it with that. You are free to use it whatever you like. But you have to think about keeping it maintainable on the server, and that is the solution that I choose.
Being live stream, so a lot of people from live stream a couple of days.
Cool.
Any more questions?
Hi.
Hi.
Could you please show me how you link the Drupal templates to the templates you create? Because you don't have a template folder.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes.
Just the naming or?
Well, let me see, let's create a new file. So there's the templates directory in Drupal, and then you would have a file named, for example, same way you can include twig files in the other folder, you can do so in here as well. The only thing, of course, that will happen in this file is that you'll have to map the values in the fields of Drupal to the values or fields or variables that you have to find your own system. The convenient thing is that if something has the same name, you don't have to specify it. So for example, if you have a variable called name and then your avatar template is called name as well, you don't have to do this. This is done for you automatically. But if, for example, you have something like field text dot value or something, you can do something like this to get the actual text value and the name variable. And if you really need to, you can include some markup here as well. I would consider it cheap, but you can.
Thank you.
Is there big test above Fraxel or Bethlehem?
Well, actually, if you remember one of the first slides, I talked about Brett Frost and his blog post about atomic design. He actually is one of the developers behind Bethlehem. So I think one of his reasons to think of atomic design, of course, if you need to do something about it, and he came up with the atomic design idea, and then he came up with Bethlehem Lab, all developers, but they make Bethlehem Lab to enrich the idea of doing this and being able to build startups. I personally have not worked too much with But the overhead you need to incorporate KSS is actually really small. All you really need is just the comments in your CSS file. There's no naming conventions you have to hear, you don't have to think about following names, search scores, members, and so on and so on. And I also really like the output. I think that it's not the previous one, sorry, of KSS, it's not the previous output, but it's really functional and pretty easy. Just see the bottom tells you to focus on the thing you're building.
Any more questions?
I was looking at PetroMap a while back, and one of the promises that it made was that it allowed designers and copywriters and everybody to work together much sooner in the process. And I was wondering, is this something that you were able to achieve as your company as well?
Definitely, yeah. It's often that the way that these things often happen might differ between companies, but usually I get a design, just to work out a design with some buttons in there and just a whole bunch of speed. And of course, then the developers. We and all developers think how they can split the components. And sometimes there's variations between components, for example, there's a button that has a bit more padding in one page, a bit less padding in the other page. But then we need to solve everything in place, even though it's not directly reachable for the developers, sorry, for the designers, and it will help to define what the default should be. So often I would just go to the designer, say, hey, we should please call me after 5 minutes, respond to the style guide, and they can easily spot any difference from what the edge might. So just having one set of truth, and of course the idea if you change the style guide, it will ultimately change the Drupal as well, and the rest of the site as well. It'll really help in understanding each other, both in making sure that what we develop is what designers have in mind, and that what designers have in mind is what we are developing. So yeah, we really see that having a style guide in place is really convenient. Also for the backend developers, for example, of course, there's difference between backend developers, but there are backend developers who fear anything within the team directory of Drupal. But then having a pretty easy way of saying that it's just open an HTML file, scroll through it, tell me which one you need, makes it easier to discuss components and things. It can also help in implementing it in various ways.
Thank you.
Some more questions.
One more.
Could you tell a little bit more about the workflow in order, like the style guide you say is created by the developer? But I can also imagine that a designer from Sketch or something creates a style guide and put it in an app like Zeppelin or how do you do that?
That's the exact workflow that we use in our company as well. So yeah, the designer makes a design and 9 out of 10 times it's a product to Zeppelin. So we can just go up to Zeppelin and see if we design it. We can use the inspector in Zeppelin to, you know, pick colors and see sizes, font sizes, margins, and so on. And it's pretty helpful because you can just actually copy the CSS and use it as a starting point. It's far from perfect, but it's a good starting point to at least have a common ground and to use a color solution for it. Spacing is required. So what happens is that indeed we just developers go through the second sketch, and then whatever the story requires, we pick the component first, we pick the design, we see what components. right in their language, so to speak, we can just replicate this cell right in our language. First, the ideal goal would be to have the same cell right. I think there are already some plugins that can do something similar for something for KSS, but for some activated cell right, I think. So that would be even better.
Yeah, I was curious about that.
I'm looking forward to get to the point where we can just generate the starting point from the from that in sketches. But we don't have anything for the test yet.
Thanks.